The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
She's got the news. She talks with newsmakers. She encourages us to laugh, and she cries with us. Speaking truth to power and questioning authority daily, it's the Nicole Sandler Show.
And hello, and welcome to a Wednesday. I can tell you right now, those of you watching on Facebook Live or on Twitch or on Periscope, I apologize. The software that I use to stream video had an update today. And I never used the last update because there was a problem with the sync between like when I would talk into the microphone and when my mouth would move on the video. So I went back to, instead of version 13 of this program that I use called Wirecast, I went back to version 12. So today they say, hey, version 14 is here. So upgrade. And I thought, okay, they fixed the sync problem. And I had to, and what happens is the longer I have the program open, the longer the delay between what I say and the video showing up on the screen is. So I just restarted it again as I noticed that there was a long delay and it's already, the sync is off. So bear with me today. I'm going to have to, I'm going to have to rebuild all of my shots and everything to go back to version 12, but that's my problem, not yours. it's always something. If it's not one thing, it's another. You know, such is life. Anyway, if that's the worst of my problems today, I will deal with them. Unfortunately, we have bigger problems than that, in that, you know, we've got this orange menace still in the White House. Things are just crazy. But I'm feeling encouraged. I feel like, you know, we have, despite the polls doing what they're doing, despite Donald Trump's continued gaslighting, and it's not only him, it's like everybody in his orbit, gaslighters are them, you know, telling us continuously that up is down, in is out, sky is green, you know, red is purple, on and on, you know, don't believe what you see and hear. I got to tell you again, last week I interviewed the, what was his name? Dan Partland, the director of this new movie called Unfit that is now open and streaming everywhere. So you can get it on pay-per-view. And it is... The more we watch Donald Trump, the more he opens his mouth, and the closer we get to November 3rd, which now is 62 days away, the scarier it is because he is warped. There's just something wrong with him. And despite the speculation, maybe he had a stroke or a series of mini strokes or whatever, there is something seriously wrong with him. So if you didn't hear that interview with Dan Partland, you can always go to NicoleSandler.com and look through the blog or past shows. I think I call it show archives or something, because you can go back and listen to anything. My show is not behind a paywall because I know a lot of people are in this, well, the same boat that I'm in, and I can't afford to pay monthly fees for any podcast I might want to listen to. So it's there. You can go back and listen at your leisure. And if you can afford to contribute to help support the show, well, then I encourage you to do so because that's what pays my salary. But if you can't, I'm not going to say, well, then you can't listen if you don't pay. That's just not me. So it's the old public radio model. It's on a, you know, the honor system. If you can afford it, please support the program. If you can't, listen, share it, let your friends know. You know, this show is on the air every day, Monday through Friday, 5 Eastern, 2 Pacific, at NicoleSandler.com on the Progressive Voices Network, and, you know, streaming a number of other places as well. AirProgressive.org, we're on Verdant Square Radio, we're on FYI Nation, we're on Netroots Radio, and a number of other places. So you can go back and listen to that interview that I did a week ago Monday Or a heads up that I'll be filling in for Brad Friedman and Desi Doyen on the Bradcast for on Thursday and Friday of this week, tomorrow and Friday, so they can take a nice long Labor Day weekend. I'm not going anywhere, so I may as well just be here, right? Anyway, I'm going to play that interview on Thursday, and on Friday, I'm going to share the interview I did with Rick Perlstein last Friday. So, and, you know, we update it with the current news and everything like that. So just a little programming note there for you. All right, I got news to get to, and today we're going to speak with, well, somebody who was on this show about 5 years ago. You know, I spend probably too much time on Twitter, but I've met some really interesting, fascinating people on Twitter. One of those is at COL Colonel Morris Davis. These days, he's better known as Moe Davis. He is the Democratic nominee running for Congress from North Carolina's 11th district. He is running to fill the seat that was just vacated by Mark Meadows when he went to become Dump's chief of staff. So I first met Colonel Davis, Moe Davis now, on Twitter when I followed him and he followed me back. And he's fascinating because he is a career military man, but he's a progressive. He was the chief prosecutor at Guantanamo Bay from, I think, 2007 to 2009, and he resigned because of George Bush's torture program. So, and he made noise about it. He wasn't silent. So I was thrilled when I saw that he was stepping up to run for Congress. And you know what? His opponent is about as unqualified as they come. And for Republicans, that's saying a lot because there are a lot of unqualified people out there. But he joins us today on the show, so we'll talk to him in a little while. We've got a lot of news to get to and all that, but there is a new video out from Founder Singh. And again, I don't know anything about Founder Singh. I've tried to find out about them because they're very creative. They're very talented. They first burst onto the scene, I want to say about 6 or 8 months ago, maybe a little longer, considering we've been at home, or at least I have, for 6 months now. I guess it's closer to a year. But Founder Singh, I discovered, whenever it was, when they did a brilliant song parody of Don McLean's American Pie. And not only was the song great, but the animation that went in the video was excellent. And it was the founding fathers of our country who singing the different, you know, parody verses of American Pie. And, you know, that song is interminable. And they parodied the entire thing. But they had the characters, like deep fakes of everyone from George Washington to Abraham Lincoln to Benjamin Franklin to Thomas Jefferson, all singing the different parts. And it was just great. And so that was the only one that they really had the founder singing on, but that's the name of their group. So they have a new video out today. And, it's called Dumb American. It is a parody of the David Bowie song, Young Americans. And, David Bowie makes a virtual appearance in it. Here's what I'll do. For those of you listening to the audio, I will post the video on my blog after the show, as I do every day with the, you know, the fun videos that I play. But just so you know, if you're just hearing the audio, I will tell you who the character is who's singing. It's, you know, obviously a cartoon or deep fake version of the person singing, but I will let you know so it makes a little more sense lyric wise. Anyway, with no further ado, here we go. It is Founder Singh with Dumb American. I think. Uh-oh. Here we go.
I tempted him with sexy bonds and dollar bills. She thrills, perfect puppet, pull his strings. He kissed my butt, messed with his election, still thinks he won. We know better. In Helsinki, he believed me, threw the CIA under the bus.
We know
he is a dumb American.
Dumb American, dumb American, he is a dumb American. Don't go,
we want a dumb American. He always loves when a man has missiles, maybe cause his own is small. My enemies keep on ending up dead. Dictatorship has its benefits. Yankees chain with those shady trade deals. He's like a dog who's got no bites. Father suffer, but he don't mind. Got the attention span of a fruit fly.
He jokes.
He is a dumb American.
Just keep dropping till they hit the floor. What was built in 200 years will disappear if he wins for more.
Allies, vote out that dumb American.
Dumb American, dumb American, vote out that dumb American. Please try.
He is so un-American.
Look how he's shredded. The power of NATO.
Look how he's undid environmental laws, but he's my favorite blonde. Where's our freaking wall? Ha ha, it's nowhere at all.
You blew that COVID call.
You're sing. They are. Whoops. Hold on. Let me take this down. This update is echo, 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 echo. There we go. All right. It's gone.
It's gone. It's gone.
I think. All right.
All right. All right. All right.
No, no, it's not gone. What is going on? This is what I get for updating. Damn it. This program, I should have done it over the weekend and played with it for a while. Bear with me a second, everyone. I'm trying to turn the echo off. Echo off. Echo off. And it doesn't seem to want to go off. I'm sorry if I'm echoing in your ears. And it's only for the video people. I know that my connection severed to the Flash server. I think we may not even be on video right now. It looks like we lost some video connection. Oh man, I should know better than to update an essential piece of software when I've got a show to do. All right, I got to turn this off. Come on, I don't even know what died. Which video? Let's see if I can figure it out. Okay, well, Periscope is still going. Twitch may have died. No, Twitch seems to still be going. I don't know. And Facebook, am I echoing on you? I can't even tell. Oh, my goodness. I'm so sorry. I should know better, right? All right. I'll tell you what. Once again, I have a technical issue. So
Facebook is on.
But I'm afraid if I turn up that pot, we're going to get the echo, echo, echo. So I can't even do that. Damn it. All right. So the video is working. But if I turn up this pot so I can play Audio? Oh, it's not echoing. All right, I may be okay. I'll tell you what, I got to try to fix this situation, so I'll tell you what we'll do. We will do the recorded version of What's News, because we can, and because I have no choice, because I screwed up. So we'll do that and come back on the other side to take care of more business and get to Colonel Moe Davis. Oh, all right, well, at least, you know, the audio is still working, so let's do that for now. Let's take a look at the news.
I read the news today, oh boy.
And I pushed the wrong button too. Boy, I'm having one of those days, aren't I? Hello, here we go. Let's try it this way.
I read the news today, oh boy.
It's time for Nicole Sandler's What's News from NicoleSandler.com and the Progressive Voices Network.
Another fatal shooting of a black man by police. This time in Los Angeles, where L.A. County Sheriff's deputies fatally shot 29-year-old Dijon Kazee during a confrontation Monday afternoon. Protesters took to the streets Tuesday as Kazee's family is calling for the officers involved in the shooting to be publicly named and arrested. In Portland, Oregon, where protests have been going on for 96 straight nights, Mayor Ted Wheeler has called on the community to end the senseless violence. The city's demonstrations took a deadly turn this weekend when one man was shot and killed during an altercation between protesters and supporters of Donald Trump. And in Wisconsin, Jacob Blake's family says his recovery is progressing, but they lament that national police reform is not. Blake's family on Tuesday participated in a Justice for Jacob rally and a day of service in the neighborhood where he was shot. The event was filled with food, music, voter registration booths, even a bounce house for the kids, with a theme of resilience and compassion. This happening as Trump visited Kenosha over the objections of the mayor and the governor. Never once mentioning Jacob Blake's name or addressing his shooting, Trump instead praised police and called outbursts of violence and arson in the city, quote, domestic terror. Trump participated in what was supposed to be a roundtable on public safety, where the only two African Americans seated at the dais were pastors James and Sharon Ward. When a reporter asked the Wards whether they believed police violence was a systemic issue, Trump cut them off.
Some African-American community leaders, and a lot of others actually, have said it's systemic. Where do you stand on that?
I don't believe that. I think the police do an incredible job.
Do you believe systemic racism is a problem in this country?
Well, you know, you just keep getting back to the opposite subject. We should talk about the kind of violence that we've seen in Portland and here and other places. It's tremendous violence. That's what you should be focusing on with your question.
So after the Trump administration announced that the Director of National Intelligence would no longer be holding in-person election security briefings for Congress, top Democrats demanded they resume. In a letter, House leaders pointed out that the decision to curtail briefings comes despite warnings from a top intelligence official last month that China, Russia, and Iran are seeking to interfere in the U.S. election. Meanwhile, Facebook announced Tuesday that an infamous Russian troll group that attempted to interfere in the 2016 election is doing it again through the use of fake personas and realistic computer-generated images. And they announced that they'd removed a number of fake accounts, both from Russia and the U.S., aiming to influence the election. Perhaps one reason the administration doesn't want to brief the Democrats on election security is that they're complicit in the subterfuge. ABC News reporting that in early July, the Department of Homeland Security withheld publication of an intelligence bulletin warning law enforcement agencies of a Russian scheme to promote, quote, allegations about the poor mental health of former Vice President Joe Biden. This according to internal emails in a draft of the document obtained by ABC News. The bulletin titled, Russia Likely to Denigrate Health of U.S. Candidates to Influence 2020 Election, was submitted to the agency's Legislative and Public Affairs Office for review on July 7th. The analysis was not meant for public consumption, but it was set to be distributed to federal, state, and local law enforcement partners 2 days later on July 9th. But
The Department of Homeland Security Chief of Staff flagged the report. That was nearly 2 months ago. The bulletin was never circulated. Tuesday was primary day in Massachusetts, and it seems that the Kennedy dynasty may have run its course. Congressman Joe Kennedy, who gave up his congressional seat to challenge the sitting Senator Ed Markey, failed in that challenge, marking the first loss for a Kennedy in a Massachusetts primary ever. Markey won by sticking to his progressive values against his more centrist challenger with a famous name. And although it seems impossible to mishandle the pandemic any worse than Trump already has, his administration keeps trying. Wednesday, they announced that the United States will not join a global effort to develop, manufacture, and equitably distribute a coronavirus vaccine, in part because the World Health Organization is involved. Seriously, more than 170 countries are in talks to participate in the COVID-19 Vaccines Global Access Facility, which aims to speed vaccine development, secure doses for all countries, and distribute them to the most high-risk segment of each population. The plan, which is co-led by the World Health Organization, the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovations, and Gavi, the Vaccine Alliance, is backed by our traditional U.S. allies, including Japan, Germany, and the European Union. But under Trump, America stands alone. And that's just a bit of what's news for now. I'm Nicole Sandler. If you appreciate these reports and the Nicole Sandler Show, I hope you'll consider making a contribution. My work is 100% listener supported, and I can't do it without your help. Find out more at NicoleSandler.com, and please click on that donate button. All right. I got it fixed for now anyway. I mean, the sink is off and everything. I got my work cut out for me tonight because I got to go back to the old version of Wirecast. You know, what's the old thing? If it ain't broke, don't fix it. I need to learn that lesson. Anyway, there's other news. There was some breaking news today. And it's all just nuts. You know, so people who are worrying maybe about the polls tightening a little bit, there's a bit of encouraging, I think, news in that the Biden campaign and the Democratic National Committee just announced their fundraising for the month of August, and they broke every record available. They raised $364 million in the month of August alone. That's more than double the $143 million that the 2016 presidential candidate Hillary Clinton raised exactly 4 years ago in August. And at that time, Clinton's take was considered huge as well, and it had been her most successful fundraising month to date. But again, the Biden campaign more than doubled that from 4 years ago last month. And the Trump people have not yet released their fundraising numbers, but it's got to be a good, a good sign. And apparently of the $364.5 million raised, $205 million came from online small dollar donations. So that's something to glom onto. And right now I'll take whatever I can get. The right wing crazies are going ever more crazy. The fact that they are getting behind this 17-year-old murderer from Kenosha, Wisconsin, is just astounding to me. And the fact that they're talking about him as if, you know, oh, he was defending himself. And they talk about, you know, he killed somebody. Well, he killed somebody before he opened fire on the people that we saw the video of. There was another video where we see him walking away after just shooting someone, I believe, in the head, when he got on the phone to somebody saying, I just killed somebody. And this is who they're celebrating? They've raised like $200,000 for this guy, which is just astounding to me. I just don't get it at all. And, now the pundits are thankfully calling him out. But I'm not hearing the Republicans call him out. I'm not. And that's a shame. For instance, this guy, Clay Higgins, who's a congressman from Louisiana, wrote a Facebook post yesterday in which he said that armed demonstrators in his state should be met with force. And he posted this on Facebook. Facebook took down his post because Higgins attached a photo of black men with guns and wrote, quote, "One-way ticket, fellas. Have your affairs in order? Me? I wouldn't even spill my beer. I'd drop any 10 of you where you stand." So this is a Republican congressman inciting violence and inciting his constituents to violence, to become violent against protesters. And of course, they have to be black. And so, great, Facebook took down his post. I want to see the House censure this person. It's just astounding to me. I know I say it all the time, but it's opposite world. Oh, and the Commission on Presidential Debates announced their lineup for this year's debates. There are three presidential debates set and one vice presidential debate. So all three of the president, all the debates will be moderated by a single moderator, which I think is a good thing. I haven't noticed anything about whether, well, I guess there will be an audience at the one in Miami, the second presidential debate happening on October 15th, because that's going to be a town hall type setting. The first and the third will both be questions and answers. The first one moderated by Chris Wallace of Fox News. The second one, it was the vice presidential debate hosted by Susan Page of USA Today. The second presidential debate, the one in Miami, the town hall, will be hosted by Steve Scully from C-SPAN. And then the third and final presidential debate will be hosted by Kristen Welker, who is the NBC News White House correspondent and a co-anchor of Weekend Today. And I'm guessing Chuck Todd's head exploded because it wasn't him. Just a guess on my part. Anyway, all right. I'm hesitant to do anything because of my setup. I'm afraid that things are going to go nuts. So I'll tell you what. We'll try. We'll try to take. I'm afraid to do this. Let's take a quick break. For the Progressive Voices Network to take some business. So let's do that. I don't know if that worked or not. Let's see. It doesn't appear to have, but it may have. Again, I totally screwed everything up because I'm a glutton for punishment. So not sure if it worked or not. But either way, let me share. I'm afraid to share a video. But I'm going to try anyway. All right. There's Miss Betty Bowers is pretty awesome, and I don't think it's going to let me do this. You know what? Okay, it will. this is a comedy of errors today. I sincerely apologize to everyone listening. All right, let's try Miss Betty Bowers spotting fake Christians in their natural habitat. Again, because I'm a glutton for punishment. Here we go. Maybe. Or not. All right. No, that's not going to work.
Amateur observers of fake Christians in their natural habitat, America, often ask me, what's the most reliable way to spot a fake Christian? Well, that's easy. They are an all too common variety of human. Your first clue that you, because you would otherwise never guess. I can hear you now. But Betty, what exactly is a fake Christian? Well, fortunately for you, you are surrounded by excellent examples, as this has become a super popular thing to be in America. Look for the obvious signs. Does the person say they follow Jesus, but nevertheless seem obsessed with abortion and homosexuality? Two things Jesus never mentioned. Does the person say they follow Jesus, but nevertheless never actually gets around to doing things Jesus did mention, like giving to the poor. Not retaliating. Donald Trump is the savior of evangelicals, truly. We are living in the golden age of fake Christians. Glory!
The first point I want to make to young people is I know that many of you think politics is bullshit and you don't vote, and you don't care. Please, please, for this election, you must come out and vote. This is the future of America. It's the future of your lives. It's whether we're going to be a democracy, whether you're going to have decent paying jobs, whether we're going to protect the environment and combat climate change for your kids. Not for yourself, but for your kids and your grandchildren. Look at what's happening in California right now as a result. Vote. And if your friends tell you that you're dumb, why are you getting involved? Look them in the eye and tell them that you believe in democracy, you believe in justice, and you want to see a better America.
Yes. Bernie Sanders. Oh, man. That is Bernie Sanders. And now I have no, there we go. This is a comedy of errors today. I'll tell you what we're going to do. I interviewed Moe Davis yesterday, so at least I know that's going to work. So without waiting any longer, let's just get right to it. Colonel Morris Davis, again, is running for Congress. He is the candidate from North Carolina's 11th district, trying to get the video up here so that I can play it for you. And take it away. Here we go.
I think.
Wow. It's coming. I think it's coming. And I think we're off of YouTube. I really, what a mess. I've had better days. Oh man, I should have known better than to do this. I'm just waiting for the lag to stop. I am a professional. Joining me on the line now is Colonel Morris Davis, Moe Davis, who is now running for Congress. So, Colonel, first of all, I was thrilled when I saw you were running because I've been a fan of yours for a long time. I'm a fan of yours since I discovered you on Twitter some years ago, and you were kind enough to appear on my show. So I want to start with introducing you to people who maybe don't know who you are, don't know your background. So why don't you tell us a little bit about the colonel part of Moe Davis.
All right. And thank you so much for having me back on. I really appreciate it.
My pleasure.
Yeah, I'm here in North Carolina's 11th Congressional District. It's the 17 most western counties in North Carolina. And I grew up, I was born, raised, and educated here in North Carolina and joined the military when I was 25, thinking I was going to do 4 years and then come back home to North Carolina. And my 4 years turned into 25 years.
Wow.
And I finally, after 36 years of being away, made it back home in May of 2019. But I guess I'm best known during my military career. I was the chief prosecutor at Guantanamo Bay for the terrorism trials. That was a job I held for a little over 2 years. And I ended up quitting over the issue of torture. You know, wow. When I had political appointees that were put in place above me that said, President Bush said we don't torture, who are you to say that we do? And told me to use the evidence that we'd been excluding for a couple of years. That's when I quit. And then more recently, I was a judge at the U.S. Department of Labor in Washington and moved to Asheville, North Carolina in May of 2019 to build a retirement home and thought I had retired. Last September, I retired from the Department of Labor and thought I was done. And then the legislature redrew the congressional map, and here we are.
Wow. And Asheville, North Carolina, is one of the probably the most progressive part of North Carolina, but it's been gerrymandered in such a way that it is actually one of the most conservative districts. Do I have that right?
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, for folks that have never been here, I've described Asheville as the Berkeley of the Blue Ridge.
Right.
So if you picked up Berkeley, flew it across the country and dropped it in the Appalachian Mountains, you'd have Asheville. Very progressive. Very artsy, very accepting, just a wonderful town. And you know, when COVID-19's over, I'd encourage folks to come visit because it's a beautiful place. We're number two in the country in breweries per capita. We trail Portland, Maine, but we're working to catch up.
I hear you.
You're right. What they did in the past, this area is very blue. And so when the Republicans took control of the state legislature, they split Asheville down the middle and put half in one congressional district, the one that Mark Meadows, that seat, and the other half went into Patrick McHenry's district.
Ooh.
So it just diluted the Democratic vote to rig the outcome of the election. Our university here, UNC Asheville, depending on which dormitory you lived in, you could either be in the 10th or the 11th congressional district because they just drew a line down the middle.
Oh, that's insane. I mean, gerrymandering is insane, but that's the prime example of what's wrong with gerrymandering. So they wanted to split Asheville because otherwise it would be a reliably blue district. And now they've split it up so that it can be run by both Mark Meadows and Patrick McHenry, two of the worst. Now, Mark Meadows, of course, left Congress to go be Donald Trump's chief of staff. But before that, he was one of the founders of the Freedom Caucus, which was the outgrowth of the Tea Party. So he's as radical right as you can get. And that's the seat that you're running for?
It is. Yeah, he held a seat for four terms. It was late November is when our court intervened and told the legislature they had to redraw the boundaries. And that was official on December 2nd. They put Asheville back together. And on December the 18th is when Mr. Meadows announced that he would not be running for re-election. So,
how interesting.
He never had to compete for it. I mean, in the past, all he had to do is get his name on the ballot. And it literally was a mathematical impossibility for a Democrat to win.
Wow. So now, because of the new redistricting laws and the challenges in North Carolina, Asheville is back together. So it should conceivably turn blue, hopefully, with your election in November, yes?
Yeah, I'm hoping. It's still, if you look at the numbers and the demographics, it's still a Republican-leaning district. Mm. But, before it was 20-plus points, and now it's more like a 6-point Republican-leaning district. And actually, voter registration here, the biggest voting block are unaffiliated voters, the independents. And they're 37%, and then the rest are kind of evenly divided between Democrats and Republicans. So it's really those unaffiliated voters that are essential in picking a winner here.
Wow. Oh, interesting. We're speaking with Colonel Morris Davis. That's his Twitter handle, COL Morris Davis, but known as Moe Davis. His website is moedavisforcongress.com. And yes, he is the Democratic nominee for the congressional race for North Carolina's 11th district. Your opponent, because it's now an open seat since Mark Meadows is out, as a young guy, he's a strange study. He doesn't seem like your typical Republican North Carolinian, I guess. Does he have any background? He's very young, isn't he?
Yeah, he has none. It's really going to be an interesting contrast for the voters to pick. We have our first debates are coming up Friday and Saturday of this week. And I think it'll be a real sharp contrast. Where I've got, a bachelor's degree, a law degree, and two masters of law, and 30-plus years of military service and government service, including working for Congress. My opponent was homeschooled. He went to college for a year at a Patrick Henry College near D.C. It's about a 300-person student body, mostly homeschooled students. And he quit. He was making, he said his grade average was about a D, so he quit. He's never had an adult job. Now, he has a compelling story. He was in an auto accident on a spring break trip to Florida. He was in an accident. He was in the passenger seat and had his feet up on the dash when the car crashed. And so he's paralyzed and in a wheelchair. And he does have a remarkable story of surviving that and overcoming it. But since then, he's never had an adult job. He's living off the $6 million he got from his accident. So he's never had a mortgage. He's never had a family. He's never had to get his own insurance. He doesn't manage his own money. Like I said, he dropped out of college, but he wants to go to Congress. Now, he couldn't finish the freshman year of college, but he wants to be in the freshman class of Congress.
So how did he win the nomination? Didn't Trump support his opponent?
Yeah, Mark Meadows, and a lot of folks are really angry at Mr. Meadows around here because he, when he announced he was not going to run, he said he was not going to endorse anyone, but he the wife of his, the best friend of his wife was a lady named Linda Bennett. And that's who Mark Meadows and Trump endorsed. And there were 12 people that ran in the race. And a lot of folks were angry that he had tried to rig the outcome. But of the 12 people, it was the two most unqualified of the 12 made it to a runoff. And then the least qualified of those two made it to the general election.
Oh, my.
So it's, he would be the youngest and the most unqualified member of Congress if he won the election.
Wow, what a stunning contrast. Well, Moe Davis, have you always been a Democrat? I mean, I ask because, you know, when I think of military, career military people, they tend to lean Republican. Have you always been a Democrat?
I have. I grew up in a family of Democrats. My dad was, and my earliest memories, I'm 62. And when I was growing up in my hometown newspaper in Shelby on election night, they put a big chalkboard out in front and somebody would come out periodically and update the numbers. And my dad would take me, you know, from time I was a kid to go watch the election results come in. And I've always been a Democrat and, you know, proud of it. So I've got my first time I ever voted was for Jimmy Carter back in 76.
Wow. Yeah, you're only a year or two older than I am. And I was my first time voting was 1980. And it was Ronald Reagan, unfortunately, was elected president on my 21st birthday. Yeah. And then Barack Obama was elected on my 59th. This time, I'm hoping the day before I turn 61, we vote Donald Trump the hell out of Washington. So, you know, so yeah, I'm glad to hear that. Now, I'm looking at your website. Again, it's MoeDavisForCongress.com. And I really appreciate it because under vision, you list your position on a number of issues. A lot of candidates don't. They like to, you know, be wishy-washy. You say where you stand. So the first one up there is healthcare. And you don't come out and say that you're for Medicare for all, but you are for a public option. Tell us.
Yeah, it's healthcare is a critical issue here in this district. There, like I said, there's 17 counties, and every one of our counties, the percentage of people that are uninsured is above the national average, and that was before COVID-19 hit. So healthcare has been a critical issue before COVID-19. Yeah, I support a government-funded public option so that everyone from cradle to grave has the ability to go to the doctor. But I also believe if folks want to procure their own coverage, or I'm endorsed by the AFL-CIO, and they've negotiated benefits that they'd like to keep. And so I support the right of folks to do that. But, you know, we spend more money than any country in the world on health care, and we have more than 10% of our population has no coverage. So clearly we can do better. And so I think a government-funded public option gives people the ability to get the care that they need and not to have to file for bankruptcy if they have an accident or an injury. I've met too many people that said, look, I thought I had a good job and good insurance until I got cancer and I maxed out my policy and had to file for bankruptcy. And, you know, about 6 out of every 10 personal bankruptcies in this country are because of healthcare costs. So we can clearly do a much better job and make sure we've got everybody covered.
So would you be opposed if, now Joe Biden is not for Medicare for all, but if we were to go in that direction, is that something you would be in favor of in the long term?
Well, I just want to make sure everybody has coverage.
Gotcha.
That nobody should have to forego being, you know, going to the doctor or have to weigh up, you know, whether, you know, with a huge copay, do you try to, you know, tough it out or do you go? So, my belief is that if we allow folks to keep, you know, procure their own insurance, I believe the private market will eventually collapse just under its own weight.
I think so,
you know,
too.
About 37 cents of every dollar that's spent on private insurance coverage goes to profit, overhead, and administrative costs. And so my belief is if we have a public option that eventually it will overcome the private markets.
Right.
But if I go out to the rural counties here and say, I'm going to force you onto government insurance.
Right. That won't go over
like
very
Beto
well.
O'Rourke said he was going to come take your assault rifle.
Yeah.
So,
right. We have to realize.
My opponent's position is that to fix the healthcare problem, we need more insurance companies.
Oy. Yeah. And we have to realize, you know, you are running in North Carolina, and as progressive as Asheville is, your district also encompasses a lot of areas around it, which are not so progressive or are not so democratic. You know, the same way I'm looking through under the environment, obviously you are for renewable resources and everything, but you don't come out and say you're endorsing a Green New Deal.
Yeah, again, it's one of those issues. It's like Obamacare. If you went out to some of our rural counties and you talked about Obamacare, you're immediately labeled a socialist and they tune you out. But if you said, hey, look, what do you think about including folks with a pre-existing condition, allowing them to have coverage? They liked it. And if you said, what do you think about allowing your kids to stay on your policy till they're 26, where they're established and they're up and running on their own? They liked it. They loved the components. They hated the label.
Right.
And I think Green New Deal is in that same category. So what I'm advocating, North Carolina, and a lot of folks don't know this, we're number two in the nation in solar energy production.
Really?
Behind California.
Mm-hmm.
And I would love to see us become the epicenter for the East Coast for alternative energy. My wife, Lisa, and I just, as I said, we built a retirement home and we moved in about 9 weeks ago.
Wow.
And we put in solar and geothermal and have a solar battery. And it was federal tax credits and a energy company rebate that make it economically feasible to do it. And so I think we can win over some of those voters. If you went out and said Green New Deal, they're going to slam the door in your face.
Right.
If you go out there and say, how would you like not to have to write a check to the power company every month? They'll listen. And for what you, you know, with the incentives, your solar is roughly the price of a power bill. And after 10 or 12 years, you've paid it off and it's money in the bank. And I think we can also reach them on national security grounds, because if you're making power on the roof of your house, we don't need troops in the Middle East guarding pipelines and shipping lanes. So I think there's an opportunity to get folks to do something environmentally friendly that you know, otherwise wouldn't, by appealing to them on economics and national security grounds.
Sure. Now, when it comes to national security, I would think, obviously, you've got a great advantage over your opponent. You're a career military man. How do you feel watching Donald Trump attempting to conduct foreign, I hate to call it diplomacy, whatever he does, it is he does. I mean, I've watched in horror as he's alienated our allies and kissed up to authoritarian figures around the world. It must make you a bit crazy, huh?
It does. And that's one of the reasons I decided to get into the race. I mean, I literally, you know, I was enjoying being retired for a couple of months. And then when they redrew the boundaries, you know, I just figured I've got too many years invested in defending democracy to watch it go down the drain. And I figured if I wasn't going to do it, who was? But one of my big concerns is on foreign policy and national security. I don't know I'll live long enough to ever see us undo all the damage we've done. The one that really galls me is abandoning the Kurds in Syria after they fought and died, fighting ISIS for us, and then we left them high and dry.
Because his buddy Erdogan asked him to do it. It's insane.
Yeah, it is. We need, and another one right now is, you know, after, you know, Putin was putting bounties or paying the Taliban to target U.S. troops in Afghanistan, and we're 60 plus days in, and you still haven't had our president do anything to Putin. I mean, I've been saying I wish he would treat Putin like he does Portland. It would be a big improvement.
No kidding. Yeah, and that's not going to happen. It is frightening, and so it would be nice to have a you know, somebody who's served his country, who knows what's up in that seat, as opposed to somebody who didn't make it through a first year of college. Moe Davis is with us. He is the Democratic nominee for Congress for North Carolina's 11th district. You are in gun country and you own guns. You're a gun person, but you're in favor of sensible gun regulations?
I am. I grew up hunting. I was probably 7 years old when my dad got me a 410 shotgun, and I grew up hunting. I worked as a bail bondsman when I was in college and carried a gun, and spent 25 years in the military, and I'm a multi-gun owner. So what I'm advocating is that, I believe you have a Second Amendment right to a rifle, a pistol, or a shotgun with a thorough background check and stringent red flag laws. But what I'd like to see happen, if you want something above that, like a military-style weapon, first off, I think you ought to go to your recruiting center and sign up, and you can carry one every day.
There you go.
But right? Short of that, I would like to say, here in North Carolina, we have a concealed carry permit process where if you want to conceal carry a weapon, you have to pay a fee and file an application. There's a background check, your criminal record, your mental health record. You have to pay to go to a day-long gun safety course and pass the test at the end. And you sign saying if you're arrested for an act of violence or hospitalized for a mental issue that it's reported to the authorities. I'd like to see that used as a standard nationwide for folks that want to own something above a traditional pistol, rifle, and shotgun. I think it'll weed out. I mean, I think a lot of the folks that are not a lot. Some number of people that buy these military style weapons, I think, do it for the, you know, the macho factor. Mm-hmm. And I think if we made it a little more difficult and more costly for them to have to go through these extra hurdles, it'll keep some from doing it. And it'll also weed out some people that shouldn't have them to begin with. On top of that, I support a buyback program. So if folks want to sell a weapon, rather than putting it back out on the streets, have a government buyback program to take it off the streets. And then I believe in strict liability. I'm a gun owner. You know, if I leave my pistol sitting on the seat of my car and leave the car unlocked and somebody steals it and uses it in an act of violence, I should be strictly liable for the consequences. So, I mean, I know those aren't perfect solutions. And I've talked with some of the families of mass shooting victims, and they agree. They'd love to have a perfect solution. Mm-hmm. But after years and years and years of doing absolutely nothing, they appreciate someone trying to do something
right,
that has a chance.
Incremental steps, at least in that direction. And everything you said is good common sense. What were your thoughts when you saw this 17-year-old kid who crossed state lines from Illinois into Wisconsin with an AR-15? Apparently, his mother drove him there to protect property. And then claimed self-defense after he killed two people and severely injured a third. An AR-15, what? And we have the president and Republicans defending this guy. There's something really wrong with a society that lionizes somebody like this, isn't it?
It is. And it's clearly a strategy on, the right. We got an election coming up, so nothing works better than motivate people than fear. And that's what they've been doing, stoking fear and division. We've been rowing against each other for too long. I'd like to see us try rowing together and see what we can accomplish. But the 17-year-old could not lawfully possess that weapon. So for his mother to take him there, I mean, she's an accessory to the crimes that he committed, and to hear the president defend it when he often never speaks out for victims of gun violence is just, to me, reprehensible. That's the country that we're living in right now. And I believe that, that good people are in the majority. And I'm optimistic that on November 3rd, they're going to get up and go vote and just send a resounding message. We need to have an outcome that is so clear on November 3rd that no reasonable person can dispute it, and start putting good judgment and common sense and decency, making that great again, rather than a president who wants to divide us and stoke fear. And my opponent, he keeps talking about Portland, and he's been down to the disabled veteran who was bilking people out of hundreds of thousands of dollars down at the border, that was indicted with Steve Bannon for fraud.
Oh, yeah.
My opponent, you have to be 25 years old to serve in Congress. And on August 1st, he turned 25 and spent his birthday with Mr. Colfage, who's the guy that was indicted with Steve Bannon down on the border. And he talks often. And he shows the pictures from Portland. And he has a checklist where he compares himself to AOC. And I keep reminding him that he's running against MOE, not AOC. And we're running to represent Pisgah Forest, not Portland.
There you go. MOE. And we need you in Congress. I mean, the more I know about that guy, the more I want you in Congress. But as I said, I've been a fan of yours ever since I found you and we became followers of each other on Twitter. Colonel Morris Davis is how you find him on Twitter. The website is Moe Davis, M-O-E Davis, for Congress.com. The first debates, you say, are this coming weekend. And I'm sure we'll be able to find them online. If we're not in North Carolina, I'm sure it'll be somewhere, the wonders of the internet. If people want to help you out, the best way to do it is go to MoeDavisForCongress.com and volunteer or donate money, I'm sure. It would be wonderful to finally have a Democrat representing North Carolina's 11th district. Asheville deserves a good progressive Democrat representing them in Congress. I know enough people there who I know would love to have you there, and I would love to be able to call you congressman. So hopefully that'll happen soon.
Well, thank you so much. I'm looking forward to it. We've got better days ahead, but we've got to sprint to the finish and make sure we win it this time and not coast like we did in 2016.
Oh, really? This is all hands on deck time. This is no time to, you know, sit out or be wishy-washy. And not only do we need to, you know, kick the orange menace out of the White House, hold on to the House and increase the numbers and take back the Senate. We need to do all of it. And there is no other choice. I mean, we need to make this happen. So thank you for running. Thank you for giving up your retirement to continue serving the people. I'll speak on behalf of my fellow Americans and say we really appreciate it.
Well, it's been a privilege, privilege.
And there you go. Colonel Moe Davis. Joining us on the show. We taped that yesterday, thankfully, so the technical problems I'm experiencing didn't affect it too terribly. Moe Davis for Congress.com, M-O-E is how you spell Moe. And, well, first of all, Asheville deserves to have a Democrat representing them. And I'm glad that, you know, redistricting happened. North Carolina is the first state in the nation to vote. And I think they start voting very soon. So, that's a good sign. Tomorrow is Thursday. Howie Klein usually joins us on Thursdays, but he has to take tomorrow off to deal with some personal stuff. So, actually, I'm going to speak with a woman named Andrea Valdez. She is the editor-in-chief of a new news outlet called The 19th. Which stands for the 19th Amendment, and it's women powered. So we'll find out what's happening with that. And then again, guest hosting for Brad and Desi, tomorrow night. And then back on Friday, we'll have Digby come in to, help us finish the week. I guess she watched Donald Trump speaking from where I think he was in North Carolina today, of all places. And apparently he went even further off the rails than he already is, which is frightening because the man is, you know, usually quite nuts. I don't know if that's the technical term, but he is off the rails. I know what's going on. I have us in the wrong place. Okay, now I can play the music theme going out. Whoops, that's not it either. I'm having one of those days, you know. I think tonight I will get some good sleep and come back tomorrow with the old version of the software. It was so nice. We went for, a few weeks with no technical problems. And, we made up for it today, didn't we? Thank you for bearing with me. I hope you stayed and enjoyed Moe Davis. I know I certainly did. I thank you for putting up with the technical problems today. I promise you we'll be back to fewer problems tomorrow. All right. Thanks for listening, everyone. I'm going to sign off now and cut my losses. Thanks for listening. Visit NicoleSandler.com to find past shows, to donate, to read, explore. It's a wide open website. There's a lot of good stuff there, so do check it out. Thank you for listening, everyone. I'll see you tomorrow. It'll be better then. I promise. Bye.